This program was first broadcast on Canterbury's access media station, Plains FM, and was made with the assistance of New Zealand On Air.
Welcome to Earthwise, Environment and Peace with Justice interviews on Plains FM 96.9.
Welcome to Earthwise. I'm Lois Griffiths. Today's guest is Dr. David Robie, New Zealand author, journalist for over 40 years, and a media educator. He has a passion for the Asia-Pacific region, for helping stories from the Pacific Island countries to reach the wider world. And we interviewed Dr. Robie about this important issue on our previous program. The podcast can be found on the Plains FM website.
And David has a passion, too, for the profession of journalism, investigative journalism, for fearless truth-telling, which in many parts of the world can be very dangerous. Now, today we'd like to focus on Israel and the occupied territories, as we have many times before, but this will be another new aspect, this time mostly on Gaza, but not just Gaza. So welcome to Earthwise, Dr. David Robie.
Kia ora. Marina, good morning. Very happy to be with you again. Thank you.
Well, David, as John Pilger said, Palestine is still the issue. And for me personally, Palestine has been an issue for decades because we've been there. Not to Gaza, but to the West Bank, to Jerusalem. We've talked to small groups about what we've learned. We've written letters. We continue to learn. And yet, it's been difficult to keep the issue alive. But now, what is happening in Gaza now is nightmarish. So very disturbing, or should be, and yet, are we, the public, here in New Zealand and other countries, including US and UK, are we getting the true picture from journalists, international Palestinian journalists, on the spot?
Well, I'd say no. We're getting a very sanitized version through our media, particularly in New Zealand. Less so in Australia, but it's pretty bad there. I was there towards the end of last year, and I was shocked at some of the media coverage there. But if you really take what's happening just today, for example, you would have thought that the UN Security Council resolution, the historic resolution, in spite of all the sort of obstruction by the United States, the vote was so clear-cut, 14-4 immediate ceasefire, and only the US abstained. You would think this is the biggest news of the moment, in the last day or so, given we've had almost 6 months of horrific war. And yet, I looked at the New Zealand Herald this morning and woke up, and the whole of the front page is devoted to the alleged Chinese cyber warfare against New Zealand and also Canada and the US and so on. And the actual the resolution from the UN Security Council, and of course whatever the consequences of that are, was buried away in the middle of the newspaper, tucked away in the centre page, and not even angled on the historic resolution itself. The headline was, Israel lashes out after United States allows a UN resolution to pass. That in itself tells you some of the problems that we're actually facing in the media. A sanitized version of what's been happening in the war, and very biased and slanted towards Israel and Israeli sources. And yet, clearly, internationally, it's a prior. To have such an overwhelming, to my mind, it's actually sort of horrendous that it's taken all these months to get a ceasefire resolution. But of course, we were blocked from this by the United States for so long, and even its own resolution that it put up immediately prior to this latest resolution that was passed, the one that it actually proposed after blocking three previous resolutions. It was an entire attack on Hamas. There's 41 paragraphs in that draft resolution that the US had come up with. And that's the problem. The US is actually shielding Israel, has done not even just in this war, but from the time that the settler colonial project, the Zionist project, began in 1978.
And even earlier, too.
Even earlier, yes, that's right. Yes. But, of course, we had the Nakba in the 1948, and this really has been what's a continuation, if you like, except far more horrendous now with the assault on Gaza. And one of the things that really irritates me about the media, as I mentioned earlier on, I've been a journalist for a long time. I've worked for international news agencies, AFP in France, French news agency, and also Gemini, which was a news agency. It doesn't exist now, but it was devoted to developing countries and to provide an independent agenda, if you like. And I'd say that essentially what we've been seeing in the media is a very biased view of coverage. And I think we're exceptionally badly served in New Zealand because we don't really have independent media. We have a small pool of news media which seems to have more or less the same sort of consensus around news. There's no pushback from journalists themselves, because to my mind, this is one of the biggest crises, not only globally, politically, from a humanitarian perspective. It's actually a crisis for credibility of media. And journalists really have to make a decision where they stand. Are we journalists for truth, or are we stenographers for power, stenographers for power? You know, I mean, that's one of the essential points. Lois, I really like the fact that you brought up John Pilger's, the late John Pilger's quote at the beginning about Palestine is still the issue, and you mentioned, of course, it has been all this time. But I would like to sort of highlight Nelson Mandela's own quote way back in 1997. I think he said it during the International Day of Solidarity with the Palestinian people. Nelson Mandela reaffirmed his support for the Palestinian rights for self-determination. And he said, "We know too well that our freedom is incomplete without the freedom of the Palestinians." And getting back to my point about the coverage in the media describing it incessantly as a war, how can you really sort of justify it, describing it solely as a war, when you've got one of the most powerful military nations in the world backed up by the United States military budgets? And you've got, it's basically a nuclear power. It's got the Air Force, it's got 380,000 reserves of soldiers. It has massive military might, the most advanced in the Middle East and so on. That's on one side, and on the other side, you have a very small force of resistance fighters, because that's what it is. Hamas is not a terrorist movement. It's a resistance movement. It's every country that's been colonized and so on has had a resistance movement of some sort. Remember that in South Africa itself, Nelson Mandela's party, the African National Congress, was at one point classified as a, quote, terrorist, unquote, organization, and Nelson Mandela was in jail himself as accused of being a terrorist, and then, of course, became the leader of the country, and ANC is the major political party. And that has been the history of many countries seeking independence. Palestine has been colonized. The current war is really a series of massacres, a massive massacres. Francesca Albanese, the reporteur, the UN reporteur for the occupied Palestine territories, has just come out with a major report saying that it's entitled "Anatomy of a Genocide." And she's given all the evidence that she's a very well-documented document. It's about 28 pages, I think, with all the evidence that she's got. And she said, basically, the world is seeing now the bitter fruits of Israeli impunity. There's double standards that have continued for so long, that the impunity that Israel is being given, this double standard, and it's an enormous threat to our whole system of international laws. The system of laws that was introduced after the Second World War precisely to prevent another genocide or genocides since the Holocaust during the Nazi Holocaust during the Second World War. But what we see now, I think, is particularly the United States and the Western countries seem to be prepared to sacrifice the international legal system that was introduced to prevent such a genocide again, simply to protect Israel's industrial war machine, which to me seems incredibly shocking and disturbing when you think that for most of our lives we've been subscribing to international law.
Well, let's talk about your profession of journalism itself. I mean, as Martin said, it's dangerous in many parts of the world. And what we get in the public doesn't come straight from the journalists, does it? It goes through the owners of the journalism, the owners of media. And it seems to me there's some rules. You'd never say Palestinians retaliate, for instance. That's just not in the language. And you'd never say terrorism. What's terrorism depends on who does it, it seems to me.
Exactly. That's a good point, Lois. Exactly. And, well, of course, the fact that Hamas is described as or proscribed as a terrorist organization, well, of course, that's at the behest of the US. And many of us now have an impression of, is the US simply being sort of manipulated and controlled by Israel, which seems extraordinary, the world's superpower, being, you know, doing things politically and militarily at the behest of Israel. It's so shocking. But anyway, the terms of, I think in the eyes of much of the world now is that the narrative that we've been fed for years by the Israeli propaganda machine is that Hamas was the terrorist organization, and that was, hell-bent on destroying Israel. But our reality that we see for the last 6 months, has exposed that as a lie, that the fact is that it's Israel that is systematically destroying a people. In most people's eyes, they would see it daily as genocide. Even if the legal systems are slow to respond, the International Court of Justice full judgment on this will take some years, of course, although they did make that interim ruling of in response to South Africa that there was clearly plausible evidence that Israel is committing genocide. But since then, Israel never responded to the International Court of Justice. And it's carried on just the same as it appears to be carrying on business as usual since the United Nations Security Council ruling.
Exactly. They take no notice whatsoever of what the world says. They just keep going on month after month.
Well, this is the impunity thing, yeah. You see, because like Israel has got away with so much over so many years now, and knowing it always has the U.S. At its back. Even if the relationship seems a little bit strained at the moment, they've been able to rely on the fact that the United States would shield it diplomatically in the United Nations and other forums and so on, and the same with the Western countries. But that unity, if you like, and those countries, of course, were all had a colonial past themselves. And that sort of unity is splitting apart. I think that's very clear from the UN Security Council's vote. And even though we sort of half expected really that Israel would do nothing, it would just carry on. It's indiscriminate killing. I mean, 32,000 people. They keep coming up with this, what happened on October the 7th. And that pales into insignificance by comparison with 32,000 people more than killed, more innocent people killed, and more than 70,000 wounded. And also, you think of all those children, because the vast majority of those who are killed and wounded children, women and children, but primarily the children. So it's very much an impression of a war, quote unquote, or really massacres against children, you know, and this is appalling, absolutely appalling. And the world has stood by. And even now, as I mentioned about the Herald's response this morning, to the silence, the absolute silence. I will say about the journalists themselves. I wrote an article earlier this year for Declassified Australia about the killing of journalists in Gaza, and at that time it was over 100. 103, I think it was at the time, have been killed. Now the number is 133.
And their families.
They're all Palestinian journalists that have been killed. So clearly what is happening is Israel is trying to kill the witnesses, just as it's been killing the aid workers and the medical workers, doctors, etc., and the attack on hospitals and all the institutions of the schools, education, all the universities of Gaza have gone. It's an absolute disgrace. It's horrible, really. It's but anyway, with the journalists, you would think that there'd be outrage globally about it. And sadly, it seems to me that if brown journalists in Gaza don't count as much as journalists that might be white, American, or European, where there would have been much more outrage, and I just think that's so shocking. It makes me think of the great journalist from Nepal, Kunda Dixit, who wrote a wonderful book a few years ago called Dateline Earth. Journalism as if the planet matters. And for me, that was one of the inspirational books for me as a journalist. But anyway, one of the things he actually quoted in that book was the relative, for the Western media, the relative balance of determining coverage thresholds for deaths. He was actually quoting someone else, a media analyst. It was at a 1978 seminar, so way back. But anyway, that quote was, 10,000 deaths in Nepal, his country, equal 100 deaths in Wales, equals 10 deaths in West Virginia, equals one death next door, basically, and next door in the US. In other words, the death next door would get all the maximum coverage, but it took something like 10,000 deaths in Nepal to even rate a mention.
I've seen something like that in Herat, a newspaper I've always respected in that. It does have, Gideon Levy and Amir Ahas. I respect him for that. But they've been, every issue of Haaretz, I get on the computer, shows pictures of all the Israelis who've been captured, all the Israelis who've died. No mention about the Palestinians who've been killed.
And there's seven, to be honest, we have 7,000 Palestinian hostages. That's what Israel is holding. They're captives. They're not really described as hostages by the media, but that's the reality. That's what they are. Many of those people have never been charged. Many of them are children. They get picked up for the most minor things, such as throwing stones against a tank or something like that. How absurd. But that's ridiculous. And yet they get very little media coverage. And even when it comes down to the captives, the hostages that Hamas is holding, the issue now is, of course, a ceasefire first and then an exchange of hostages. I can't see Hamas releasing the captives unless there's a proper exchange, which is the just thing to do. I mean, why is the Western media highlighting the Israeli captives all this time and virtually ignoring the Palestinian captives and the horrendous treatment they're given in jail and so on? I've got a photograph that faces me in my office. It's a photograph of journalist Shireen Abu Ekle, who was assassinated.
I'm glad you mentioned her.
Yes, and she was assassinated by Israeli snipers, and in various investigations proved that. But, you know, Israel wouldn't accept responsibility for that, which is another illustration of their immense impunity and the double standards. But for me, she was an inspiration as a journalist. She worked for Al Jazeera. And I mention Al Jazeera now because for anybody in New Zealand, if they're relying on New Zealand media, forget about it, you know, about what's happening in the world, really. Al Jazeera, fortunately, we're one of the countries that actually has Al Jazeera's free-to-air TV, you know. So anybody can get good access to this information every day. To me, the best news services are Al Jazeera and TRT News in Turkey. My wife and I, we were traveling in the Mediterranean at the time of the first month of the war, and we weren't able to get Al Jazeera, but we were able to get TRT News. And I visited both of these organizations in Turkey and Qatar. Really impressive media organizations and very impressive and dedicated journalists. TRT News was giving a really comprehensive coverage in that first month and the real explanation, background, and so on. Because I think one of the major problems of the Western media is the lack of context and the lack of background information explaining issues and so on.
I'm glad you mentioned Shireen Abu Akleh. That's an issue that I was hoping to promote, Shireen Abu Akleh, as the symbol of what is really wrong. And that Anne Frank has symbolized the Holocaust to me, many people. Oh my God, that woman. You picture this one young woman, what happened to her, then you can see the whole ugly picture. And Shireen Abu Akleh has American citizenship. She has American citizenship. She was assassinated deliberately, covering her story. She's a striking woman. She called herself a community journalist. She not only reported what happened, but she went and talked to people. She told their stories. She told the stories of the people. And I hope that we make her the symbol of what's happening in Palestine. And yet, I got it into a Catholic magazine, a story about her, but I was hoping to get it more widespread. I don't understand our own media. Why aren't they angry about what's happening to journalists? Why did they talk about Julian Assange? Why did they talk about Shireen? Why did they talk about the children being killed? Something's wrong. There's a lack of passion and there's a lack of anger. And I think it's the way the media tells the story.
And it goes on, David. Month after month after month, it's getting more and more silent now. Gaza's not even mentioned in everything, any news now at all.
But isn't the owner of the media the problem, not the journalists themselves?
Yes, I think it's actually a combination of several issues. It is the media structures, the media and the ownership of media, accepted consensus that media organizations have, but it's also journalists to blame as well, because even though the situation is perhaps worse in Australia in terms of media ownership and control, there is a major pushback by journalists questioning and challenging the narratives that the Australian media are giving. And I mentioned that Crikey, it's an independent news website, created a page on their website, and they named names. They named all the journalists that have been to Israel on funded junkets, etc.
Oh, yes.
And since then, have also named journalists going to Palestine territories, occupied Palestine territories, and so on and so on. It's only a very small number there. But the main influential journalists in Australia, they're named. Editors of The Age, the editors of the Sydney Morning Herald, or the key television editors and so on, the policy makers, the editorial policy makers in Australian media have all, not all, but a vast majority of the key influential ones have been to Israel on the junkets Israeli narrative.
Not independently.
Some have gone independently, but most of them have been as guests of Israeli support organisations. And that website is there for public consumption, and it's constantly updated. I just checked it this morning, and the latest update was about just a few days ago. And when I previously looked at it, I think it's the time when I was writing about the killing of journalists in Gaza. At that stage, they had about 77 journalists in Australia listed who had been on Israeli information sort of junkets, if you like. And since then, it's now about 130 or so, you know. And so, but these are exposed. These are exposed by other journalists. Crikey sort of challenged the media organisations on their policies because they claim to be independent and they claim to have objective news values and so on. And yet, clearly, these are many of the media organisations. They're actually being challenged, including the ABC, the public broadcaster in Australia. Now, in New Zealand, we know there are a number of journalists that have done this as well, but no one has actually done any research or exposed this. And so the silence is complicity. I mean, that this epithet is quite common around now, but it's the fact. Silence is complicity, because this is a massive, you know, horrendous thing that's happening in the world today. Mm. And if we just accept it, then we're complicit, you know.
I'm going to have to interrupt because we are running out of time. But I want to say how much I appreciate what you do in talking to us. I just mentioned a website that you often write for, asiapacificreport.nz. And also mentioned a journalist, Jonathan Cook, that we followed. And I just want to finish with a quote, similar to what you were just saying, from the Lutheran pastor, Munthu Isaac. His Christmas message. Gaza today has become the moral compass of the world. If you are not appalled by what is happening in Gaza, if you are not shaken to your core, there is something wrong with your humanity. So thank you for your work, David Robie. We respect you so much. And we'll just finish with a little bit of music, I hope.
Yeah, thank you so much for being with us again.
Oh, kia ora, thanks very much.
From us at Earthwise, goodbye.